Hello, welcome to Naresh IT. In the last video, I was talking about where you will going to see a big data in the real environment. So you've been doing with lot of things in the applications. Okay, we don't going to talk in application things. This is not OLTP problems. Okay, this is purely a OLAP problems. Okay, it's all analytical processing. So in the yesterday's part, or in the last video part, we spoke about, okay, what is this 30 days data? So why I have to process this 30 days data? It's a kind of a data lake where you will going to push the data from different systems, and you prepare a data lake, and from the data lake you will going to do some kind of analytics which will going to bring good revenue to your company. So we don't talk about something like, okay, front end things, and how do we push the data and how do we carry the data across the systems. Okay, we just push the data in a data warehousing locations and where you will going to apply an analytics. Nowadays, if you see that any companies hold lot much data, okay, it's not like, okay, your company didn't have a lot much data, okay, you've been collecting the data, whether it is a banking domain, whether it is an insurance domain, whether it is a telecom domain, whatever might be the business, okay, understand, right? You will be having lot much data, but these companies didn't have a good infrastructure, okay, they all rely on a database, like a single server model. They'll keep all the data in a single location. So they didn't make a dream to process that huge data to make a revenue from that. That's really a very important thing nowadays, because more things are going to digitalize nowadays. So everyone wants to make use of the data what they have. But this, you know, your traditional systems, that really cannot process the data. So that's what we have seen in the last video. That kind of data, we call it as a big data. Your traditional processing systems really can't do anything, because it have a lot of drawbacks. It cannot process huge data. It can process the things in a sequential manner only. It cannot process it. But companies wants to make money of the existing data. How do they going to bring it out? So let's talk one scenario again. Okay. So where actually people will going to come across this big data and how do they solve it? So as I spoke yesterday, you know, look at this. Let's say you have XXX is a service based company who is providing a services to, let's say, Facebook, or let's say some other applications like Wells Fargo, or let's say any big application, Walmart. So what these companies are doing, right, like CTS or Infosys or TCS, these are all service based companies. They are providing services to product based companies. They are providing services only. They are not providing analytics. So nowadays, these companies, what they are doing as a proof of concepts, they are just providing analytics along with their service. So how do they provide analytics? What way they are processing it out? Okay, so let's talk about that. Let's say yours is a Wells Fargo company. Okay, so Wells Fargo have a lot of different verticals like loans and debits and credit cards. Okay, or let's say it's an insurance system, a new business agent system, and as well as some reinsurance, and there are lot much other different systems will be there. Okay, like in-force business, a new business, these are all different systems you maintain in insurance, or if it is a banking, it can be a credit card, debit card, and you know, loans and repayments and all these things. Okay, and in banking also you are getting something called insurance as well. Okay, so now what you will do, you would like to push the data into a data lake. Okay, so people uses this one as a data warehouse earlier days. So this is a purely a data warehouse stuff. Okay, so in this data warehouse, there are lot many drawbacks are there. Let's say here, people wants to process this data which you have collected from different systems to provide analytics, but you know, you are not providing analytics very faster. So when, let's say if it is a bank, every first of the month or 15th of the month or every third month of that year or sixth month of the year, okay, like that, you are every end of the year, you will going to have a huge data pushing into your systems. Okay, so then the data will be coming into the data warehouse is very huge data, and it takes lot of time to process. If it is a 1 terabyte of data you have to process, if you really get a 1 terabyte of data, it's very hard to process it by using your on hand database management systems or any on hand processing systems. Okay, understanding, right? So when you are doing that one, it really takes lot of time. It will take 2 days to process. So how do you going to reduce this time? This is really taking lot of time because it's a huge data. You can't process it out that one. So how do you process it? Let's say you have a challenge to a data engineering team now. Data engineering team should process the data very faster. How do they do that? So simply what they will do, right, on these days they will bring out all this 1 terabyte of data and they will place us into different engine, different servers they will maintain. Okay, so right now we are talking about a problem. What is that problem? The problem is what called 1 terabyte of data. Okay, how do you process it out? So we are talking right now about a solution. Okay, then we will see how a framework like Hadoop comes into picture. So without using Hadoop, what is the problem and why you have to use that framework? First, when you are learning something, you should put out something. Yeah, if I don't use that framework earlier, how would they have processed it out? And what are the problems and how this tool is providing a solution? So the problem is what? A big data. Okay, and the solution, let's say a manual solution, let's say if there is no Hadoop in your company, how do they just go into process that one? So we will see that part right now. So let's say here, so you have divided that 1 terabyte of data into 4 parts and you will place us that 4 parts into 4 different servers. Assume that this is a servers. So 250 GB data, you have pushed it, you have divided into 4 parts and you have placed this data in this 4 different servers. Earlier you used to run a program on this 1 terabyte of data, right? These are the two things. For your big data problems, you have storage, you are using something called RDBMS, and for processing you are using something like JDK or .NET or PHP or Android, whatever it might be. Okay, you are just using that programs to process it out. Okay, so these are the things, like you are just processing the data in a traditional manner. Fine, keep it that aside. So what is the problems here, right? Your RDBMS cannot process that 1 terabyte of data here. So how do you provide a solution? So let's say this is on regular year, but nowadays due to the denominization, every day bank is full of huge data. So at that time, every day your database will go into process more than 1 terabyte of data, which really big problem to a bank applications. At that time, how do they are providing, how do they can get some analytics on that huge information? Nowadays, lot much information is collected in bank. How do they going to use that bank data to attract new customers or to improve the more digitalization forms that you are receiving it out? So for that one, we are seeing that a solution, a manual, not any framework. First of all, you will going to do, you will receive that 1 terabyte of data and you will divide and distribute the data into 4 servers. Clear, right? That is your first task. And what is your next task? You have a program which you used to run on this database. Now what you will do, you will bring that program to the location where you are running the program, where you have a data. So I will copy the same program into 4 machines manually. I am telling not any framework. Okay, I am just telling you how do you solve this big data problem, a manual. First you have placed the file into some parts and then you will copy the program to all the location where you have distributed the data. And the third one is what, after completing this processing, right, you will have to combine the data of the 4 parts. So what will happen, the program will going to run on this data parallelly. This program also runs on this data parallelly. This is different data, this is different data. Program is same, but data is what, different. So you will going to process this data parallelly. After completing this execution, how much time it took? Earlier it took 2 days to process. You have divided that 1 terabyte of data into 4 parts and you are processing it parallelly, and it will be completed within 12 hours. Earlier it took about 48 hours. Now it completed within 12 hours. You have saved 1.5 day business. So it's really a big deal. You know, in the real world, when you are saving some time in batch, which will help you to make your application online, it's a really a big thing. So now you are doing something manually and you have saved 1.5 day for your company to process that huge data. Okay, understanding, right? So after that, after 12 hours data, you will going to combine all the parallel output and you will going to form a single file. So means you have to combine that one, right? You are doing everything manually. So you need to combine the 4 parts as a single part and you have to give it that single part to some downstream systems. Okay, because your output will be input to some downstream systems like customer care support. They will be getting your report and they will check out the report and they will going to call the people. You know, this is a data, like as I said, right? You will perform some analytics like, okay, if a people are using good credit card rates, I mean to say he have a good credit card rates, you can offer him a good learn within a short time. You don't need to spend a lot of time because you already had a good information of his history. You will going to help him to get a loan very fast. If I get a loan approval within 5 minutes, I would like to take a loan very easily. So that is kind of analytics you want to push it out. You know, earlier days, if there is no data warehouse, what you will going to do? A credit card system has to communicate with the loan systems by using web services, which is very costly. Okay, you will going to exchange the data by different web services. Really, it's a costly because right, if it is a small data, there is no big deal. Okay, if it was a huge data, web services are costly. So instead, you will maintain a data lake where you can push out all the data from all the systems. You can do better analytics there. So a web services is kind of something called real time. But we really in a real time, you can just transfer 2 records or 3 records are like this. You can't transfer the terabytes of data across the system. So you'll put it out in a warehouse and then you'll just go into a process the data in much in detailed manner. Understanding, right? So these are the tasks you are doing manually to process the data and get some insights of the data. Okay, understand, right? So you understand what is the problem and how you solved it. You have solved it for 12 hours. So if your manager asks you to make it to 6 hours, what you will do? You will going to divide, you will going to make another 4 more servers and you will divide the data into 125 GB and you will going to have it in 8 machines. Okay, so you have 8 machines and the data will be completed within 6 hours. And one more thing is very big deal, right? When you are increasing the number of servers, you are introducing that many network errors. And you should take care about the errors also. Means, due to this one, any machine may lost its connections. At that time, you have to come back and you have to restart that. These are all your responsibilities when you are processing the huge data manually. And also, very big thing is what? You are maintaining servers, which are very, very costly. Clear, right? So, this is how the challenges. See, first of all, the problem is big data. What is the solution manually? This is how you will going to divide the data and places into different servers and you will going to process the data parallelly to complete it faster. That is the solution. But what are the challenges? These are the challenges. Now, if it is a monthly once or if it is a yearly twice, this is okay. But if the data is coming huge and you have to do these things daily, then it's really a big deal. So this is what you are doing manually is really going to a big problem. Because right, you are doing daily these tasks, which is going to be a really a big deal. So what you have to end up, you need a framework which can do these things automatically. You need a framework which can do these things automatically. Understand, right? So we need a solution. What you are doing things challenges, you want to provide a solution through a framework. What is that framework? Okay, that is what the deal here. So earlier days, you know, Google is a company which is having the problem of big data. Earlier days, whenever you are using Google, right? So Google trying to solve that processing in a distributed manner. So Google wants to do that one very first. So in 2004, whenever you type in some search engine, it takes a lot of time to bring the data. So because Google is searching something sequentially, let's take in your laptop only. In your laptop, search some file in your laptop, in your computer. It will search C drive first, D drive, E drive, F drive. Like that means it is doing sequential search. You might have a problem. You might be thinking, what is this? If I want to search, I want to search all the 4 disks parallelly, then my task will be very faster, right? So for your 1 terabyte of laptop only, you are thinking like that. For your 1 terabyte of laptop, it is taking at least 2 hours to search all the data in that 4 disks. It is really a time taken, right? You might be thinking it has to complete within 15 minutes like that, but it won't happen. Why? Because in your laptop will follow something called network file system. The network file system, what that will do, right? Look at this. It's a network file system. Network file system, if you place one file by using network file system, it will place the data in a single disk only. It won't divide and distribute the data. This is the problem that we have. So now Google wants to do that. Oh, come on. We don't want to go with this traditional network file system because the data was storing in a single location. That is the reason we don't want to go with a traditional storage system. So at that time, Google has introduced a distributed application system that is called GFS. See, Hadoop is not a direct solutions of a big data. There are lot many solutions of big data, but why we have to learn about Hadoop, we will talk slowly. Okay, so that is what Google have very big data problem, because any data issues you should come across through Google only. So Google have that problem. So for that one, Google has created a file system called Google File System. What that will do, if I place one file using this program, like our framework or a file system, what that will do, that will divide the data. If I have a huge data, it will divide the data into small chunks. Understanding it? If you divide the data, you can process the data parallelly. That is the main goal. So that is the reason Google has created a file system called Google File System. Of course, you will say that, sir, I'm using a JDK program on a traditional database. Yes, it will do a sequential processing. Of course, when I say database, the background is what? Network file system only. Means indexed network file system is nothing but an RDBMS, remember here. Okay, so this is what a program, this is what a processing part, and this is what the storaging part. Okay, so storage you kept in the traditional databases, which means it's a file system only. So what will happen, right, when you are running a program on JDK platform, what that one, right, it will connect to the data and it will going to download the data into the application server. So where you will run your program, in the application server. Application server is the location where you will deploy your applications and you will execute your, you will schedule the code and everything there. So when you use JDK and all these frameworks, what that will do, that will just going to read the data from the database and keep it in the application server, and it will go, let's say your 1 GB data, it will going to bring that 1 GB data and you will going to process it sequentially only in the application server. This is what happens everywhere. Okay, so what you are doing, I will use JDK only. You will tell that, sir, we have a problem with the storage, so we will come with the Google file system which will divide the data into different places. So you will be telling that, sir, I have JDK code, so I will JDK program, so I will going to use that program only on this data which was divided and distributed by Google file system. You understand the problem with this traditional way. This is what traditional way means, your framework or your code will connect to the database and downloads the data. This concept is called code locality. Where is code, there the data will move. Okay, so first you should understand why we have to go for a distributed applications. I already written my program in JDK, why I cannot use that program to process the distributed data. So for that you should understand a concept called code locality. So what is code locality? Code locality is doing something, look at this here. If you see that a code locality, you are trying to solve a big data problems and the Google first to find out processing that one very faster. So look at this here. To see about a code locality, you just look into this PPT, you will get a clear idea. If you see this one, look at this. This is what talking about a code locality, this particular part. Okay, this one. What you are doing, storage node means when you are running some processing, means any program, it will connect to the storage node and brings the result. It loads the data in the processing node and it will do processing and it will going to push it back to the storage node. The results will be saved in the storage node. This is what happening with the regular processing framework. This concept is called code locality, means where code is there, there your program will going to move. That is what code locality. This is a big failure to process a huge data. This is the what main reason of sequential processing. The data will be goes to the location where program is there, then program will going to execute sequentially. Is it clear, right? This is, you have to understand code locality. You might have a question, why can't I use my Java code to process the distributed data? You are telling that there is a problem of storing the data in a single location. That is the reason we cannot process huge data. And I have placed the file in a distributed file system. Can I use the same Java program or .NET program or PHP program on the distributed data? Remember, all that frameworks comes with a concept called code locality. So you can't use Java or .NET or PHP in this. If you use, what will happen? Let's say I have used Java or Scala or Python or R language, any language, what you will do, right? If you're working with GFS file system, the main deal of the program is what? To download the data from a data locations and put the data in a application server. Okay, so you will going to bring out all the data from the all the distributed locations and you will form as a big file, and then again you will do sequential processing only. Which means that not only storage system, okay, the storage system is what distributed system you made, but that system, right, okay, which will divide and distribute the data, but you know, processing framework also should, you need a distributed one. not only storage part. So Google has created one storage part to make it distributed, that is called Google File System for the storage. And then Google has introduced one more distributed application. So what is this? You can't use JDK or .NET or Python or R, any processing language, to process the distributed data, because what they will do, they will copy all the data from the distributed parts to a single location. Again, you will do sequential processing. So this is not going to work. So you need one tool, or you need one processing framework, which will be process the data distributed, which means you have to copy the program to the locations where data is there. That is you want right now, not passing the data to the program. You have to pass program to the data. That concept is called data locality. So you need a framework. First you should understand why we need to learn a distributed applications. Then we will go for Hadoop. How do you solve the problem of a big data? Here, if you see in this diagram, in the last use case I was talking about, in the second step you are copying the program manually, right? Where you are going to copy the program, where data is there, there you are copying it out. But if you use any JDK framework and all these things, what it will do? It will push out all the divided data as a single file and it will process. This is what you didn't expect, right? You want to process the processing framework also in a distributed manner. So you need some frameworks which provides data locality. So here your JDK, Scala, .NET, PHP, Python, R, all the language comes with a concept called code locality. They really don't know that earlier days, they really didn't prepared in such a way to work on a multiple CPUs engine. So you need one framework, processing framework, which provides data locality. So Google has created a first distributed cheaper processing framework, that is called MR, Map Reduce. This is what a processing engine. It's a distributed processing engine. GFS is a distributed storage system. MapReduce is a distributed processing engine. And they have created a table also. They have created a database that is called Bigtable, which is a database. You have to know the differences between Google File System and Bigtable. Remember, that's a simple one. Differences between a file system and a database. What is the differences between database and a file system? Let's take one book. If this book don't have index page, if I ask a particular concept, what a particular student will do? He will scan all pages in that book and finds a particular concept. This is what called file system. Understand, right? Because you don't have index. Let's take one book which have a index pages. When I ask a particular concept, what that student will do? He will go and check out that index and he will directly jump to the location of that file. So which will be a read access will be very faster in this databases. A database is nothing but indexed file system. It is not rocket science. A database is nothing but an indexed file system. Okay, this is what Google has provided a solutions. Look at that. Google has provided a solutions. What you are doing it manually. Earlier, what you have done the challenges, you have to divide the data and distribute the data. You no need to divide right now. A Google file system will going to do that one automatically. You have to copy the program. You no need to do it out. Your MapReduce framework will find out where is the data divided and distributed. There it copies the program. And the third one is what you have to combine. No problem. The framework only combines the data. Network issues also does that. But Google have something what costly only, because it is using in a high-end machines. They are using high-end servers. So while this process is going on, there is a guy called Duck Cutting. Okay, there is a guy called Duck Cutting. So when Google has introduced this one, GFS and MapReduce and something called Bigtable. When Google has introduced the solutions for big data, this is the solutions of the big data. Okay, so Google has he is right now collaborated with Cloudera. So he is alive. Okay, so let's say Duck Cutting. So what Duck Cutting? He is the founder of Hadoop actually, but before that he have a project. He have a web crawl engine like Google only. That project name is called Nutch. Remember here, this is a project called Nutch, which is like a Google web crawl engine only. This is also web crawl engine only, which will go into downloads all the data from the internet and creates indexes on that. So he also have a problem of a big data, but he really cannot afford of maintaining very high-end machines like Google maintain. Google maintained very costly. They have solved the big data problem by using very costly high-end machines. But duck cutting really can't use that high-end machines. So what he did, right? He have inspired, not copied, okay? He was inspired from Google file system. And he have created a new file system called Nut distributed file system, where you can go into store and process the data in a multiple commodity hardware, not high-end servers. Remember here, these are very cheap machines, your regular machines, your laptops also you can use it in a production. Remember, Java is a open source, but you cannot deploy Java on a low-end commodity hardware. Here low-end means RAM and CPUs are, and cores are very, very cheaper. It, in your real production, right, you will see a big server which is about 20 cores, 1 terabyte of RAM, like this you will see of a server. We really don't maintain that much big configurations to process our huge data. By using Nut, why you have used this much high-end machines in your production environment for Java or .NET, anything? Why? Because you have to maintain this data available at every time. Means that machine never going to lose. But when I use a cheap machines here, what duck cutting is trying to do, he is trying to do the same concept by using a very commodity machines, very cheaper machines. Then you might have a question, what happens if this machine lost? The data in that machine will lost, right? Yes, of course. What Nuts was telling, right? Hey, don't worry, my framework will mirror the data. Okay, it will going to replicate the data. If you place some data here, the data was replicated here. So there is no problem of losing the data. So that is what that file system will going to do. That is what called Nut distributed file system. So he has created a new file system where a small company can make dream of processing huge data. Earlier companies like Google only used to do it up because they can afford up because they have huge business. Okay, so now Nuts will going to do that one, and by using that Nuts distributed file system, and they have used the same concept called MapReduce only to process the data. They have changed only the file system. Now while he was doing this, actions was observed by a company called Yahoo. And Yahoo, what they did, they recruited this guy and they gave a team, and they have released a new component in 2008. That component name which can provide exact solutions for Hadoop. That is exact solutions for big data. That is called Hadoop. This much history is there to talk about Hadoop. Don't directly jump what is Hadoop. First understand why you need to learn a distributed application. And what are the, look at this, that's what we have seen. Why, what is big data? Why you have to process the big data to get some insights? So look at this here. You might have this part here. Why you have to learn something called big data, what is big data, and what you will do with that? You will get some insights and you will going to perform some actions which will going to bring a revenue. If you see this example, you will see that the data you will be collecting from the different systems, and you will provide some analytics on top of that which will bring a huge business to the company. So that is what a big data and why you have to process the big data. That problem means big data, you want to provide a solution by doing manually. These are the challenges that you will get when you process the data manually. So how do you going to overcome these challenges? At that time Google has created a solution for that, but this is costly. Then your guy called Duck Cutting has invented a new part called Nut, which will going to solve your big data problems very cheaper. So that project name, if someone asks what is the earlier name of Hadoop, that is called Nut. Okay, so this is what a framework which was released in 2008 but got popular because of its ecosystems. We will talk in the next video what is Hadoop ecosystems and everything. So this is what actually, what is an Hadoop? Okay, Hadoop is a distributed, it's not single machine. Okay, it's a distributed cluster computing engine. Hadoop is a distributed cluster, means it's not on a single machine, it will going to run on a multiple machines. It can run, it's a framework which can run on a multiple machines. Understand it? It's a distributed cluster computing. What you will do, you will perform some processings and everything, right? That is what computing engine. Okay, so here Hadoop mainly contains two parts. When someone asks you Hadoop, Hadoop is not a database. Literally Hadoop is a file system. Okay, it has something called a file storage called HDFS, and it has something called processing engine called MapReduce. Okay, so we will talk about these things in the next video. What is Hadoop and what are the ecosystems that are present on the top of Hadoop? Thank you guys, and we will meet in the next video, which will going to talk about a project flow in the real world, how Hadoop will going to do all these things. Okay, thank you much.